part of academic cells. Now coming to our today's topic, so dear friends, many people are strongly motivated to teach, as you all know. Some are already practicing in the profession, while others are just beginning to learn the fundamentals. Now two issues arise. One is, how do teachers develop capabilities necessary for successful instruction? And second is, what knowledge, skills and attitude must they acquire, and what capabilities do they need to develop in order to impart effective instruction? I think the issues give rise to a very useful, you can say, solution, or you can say answer, that much of successful instruction is the result of competent planning and delivery. So teachers have to arrange instructional events for students in such a way that appropriate learning is facilitated. And these instructional events must be carefully designed in advance if instruction is to be effective. So competent planning and delivery of instruction allow for efficient organization and presentation of instructional events, and are therefore very, very essential for effective instruction. So this session is about competent planning and delivery of instruction. And we will focus on two aspects. One is instructional planning, where we will learn the concept of instructional planning, and we will determine what to teach and plan how to deliver instruction effectively. And the second part of my today's presentation is about delivering instruction effectively, wherein we will study the three stages of instruction. One is introduction, second is development, and third is consolidation. So development will include emphasis on motivation, reinforcement, evaluation, explanation, demonstration, asking questions, or assigning tasks. Now let us come to the first part of our today's presentation, that is instructional planning. Why instructional planning? Friends, before that, let us understand the difference between the term teaching and instruction, which the teachers, the administration have been using interchangeably. The meaning of these two terms is different. Now, can you give a difference between these two terms, teaching and instruction? I give one hint. The hint is that both aim at achieving certain objectives, but it is the manner or the procedure by which these objectives are achieved makes these two terms different. You see, instruction can be facilitated through textbook or video program, but in case the student has any doubt, he cannot seek further information, further clarification, or further elaboration. Whereas teaching involves face-to-face interaction between the teacher and the students, and whenever the students find any any problem or doubt, they can ask for any kind of clarification or further elaboration. So this is the difference. Now coming to instructional planning. Instructional planning is nothing but a plan of actions of what a teacher has to perform in the classroom. So instructional planning is a teaching outline of important points of lesson arranged in the order in which they are to be presented. So it may include points to be made, question to be asked, reference to some media, reference to assignment, reference to question, reference to textbook, etc. So instruction planning is nothing but an organized statement of both general and specific goals, together with specific means by which these goals are to be attained by the students under the guidance of a teacher on a given day. So it's a sort of daily lesson planning, which involves selecting content matter, sequencing or arranging the content matter, determining the methods and procedure. So the instructional planning focus on three aspects. One is, where am I going? Of course, in the lecture, that is, what are my objectives? That is, what knowledge, skills, and attitude must the student be, you can say, equipped after the session is over. The second is, how will I get there? That is, how I will reach? That is, what instruction method, what media, what evaluation tool will be employed to reach the objectives? And the third question is, how will I know when I have arrived? Of course, you will ask few questions. You will ask questions at the end of one part, second part, or at the end of the whole lesson. So that will give you feedback to what extent your session has been understood by the students. So the lesson plan or instruction plan attempts to answer these three questions. That is, where am I going? How will I get there? And how will I know when I have arrived? Now, why planning is essential? Planning ensures presentation of the content matter in a logical, systematic, and effective way, keeping in mind at the same time the mental development of those for whom we plan to teach. So if we have got a lesson plan with us, it checks haphazard way of teaching. It keeps the teacher on the track. It avoids the danger of covering more subject matter than the student can absorb, or it avoids the danger of running out of the material. So it keeps the teacher on the track. He will be very confident. Secondly, it enables the teacher to achieve economy of time, effort, and even money. Hi, how? You see, if the teacher has planned and prepared his lecture very well, his session will be conducted in a smooth manner, so his effort will be in the right direction. Likewise, his time will be saved. And about money, you see, suppose we have borrowed some equipment or material from some outside agency and we have not integrated properly during teaching learning, then money will also go waste. So if we have thought of all these things in advance, then our session would be conducted in a smooth manner. Another is, as I told you in the beginning, that it develops self-confidence and security in the individual teacher, as he has beforehand dealt with the problems and the ways to handle them. You are preparing a lecture plan, you can anticipate the likely questions that the student may ask from you, that at this point somebody will ask this kind of question. So how to handle that question, you will also think about its solution. So it gives confidence to you and your session will be conducted in a very smooth manner. It ensures suitable use of instructional media. That is, you will show the instructional media only when the need arises, and you will remove it when it is not needed. So before showing the media, you will create a necessity. Okay, at this point, student must be shown some chart, some picture, or some PowerPoint presentation. So that means you are not simply showing the material, you are integrating in the teaching learning process. Another advantage is that you have a plan with you. It will allow you, or the student will be able to link the new learning with their experiences with their background experiences, you can say. So it ensures linkage of the past knowledge of the learner with the new knowledge by employing the principles of correlation and integration. That is, you will proceed from what they know and move them slowly to what they do not know. When the students are able to see a relationship between classroom learning and problem solving in everyday life, that will facilitate effective learning. It enables the teacher to evaluate his work as the lesson proceeds. You are asking few questions at the beginning in order to know their prerequisites. Then after covering one part of your presentation, you will ask one question or two questions. Then at the end of the second part, you will ask again two or three questions. At the end of the entire lesson, you will ask some questions pertaining to the entire chapter. So that will provide you feedback to know the extent to which your students are understanding your content matter or not. Now let me describe the components of instructional planning. The most important component is specifying instructional objectives. Objective is a statement or sentence which describes what the student will be able to do at the end of a unit of instruction. Okay, suppose the topic is Ohm's law. Now I can devise two types of objective. One is general objective, which describes the general intent of my today's lecture, and that can be stated as, after the topic is over, students will be able to understand Ohm's law, or I can say they will be able to know Ohm's law. So I have used two words, that they will be able to understand or they will be able to know Ohm's law. Now these describe the overall objective of the lecture on Ohm's law. Now for achieving this broad objective, we can think of some short-term objectives, like they will be able to define current, they will be able to define voltage, resistance, they will be able to state the SI unit of current, voltage and resistance, they will be able to name the devices which measure current, voltage and resistance, they will be able to set apparatus, they will be able to state Ohm's law, they will be able to verify Ohm's law, they will be able to draw graph between V and I, and they will be able to list situations where Ohm's law can be applicable. So these are instructional objectives I am specifying. Okay, so the detail we will take up later. Then the second is selecting the content matter. So content matter is chosen after the teacher has considered the curriculum requirements, students' needs, and time allotted for the lecture. So the accordingly, the teacher will select the content matter. Carrying out task analysis. So after having selected the topic, the next decision he has to take about, that is doing the analysis. That is, the task analysis is a process of breaking down some activity into simpler tasks, and these tasks are then arranged in a sequence, and students are taught each step or these steps one by one. Okay, so that will help you in writing the instruction objective, that will help you in the selection of instruction method, that will help you in writing the items for evaluating student performance. Another decision the teacher has to take is about instructional method for teaching a particular topic. Instructional methods aim at establishing a link between teacher input and learning outcomes, mainly in terms of realizing learning outcomes. And as you all know, a number of methods have been devised from time to time to make teaching learning very effective. You see, there are some students who learn best when they are taught in a large group. Some topics can be taught in a small group. Some topics can be taught when students are provided individualized instruction. So accordingly, we have methods which are suitable only in large group, like lecture method, demonstration. However, demonstration can be given to a small group. It can also be given to an individual student. Likewise, there are some topics which can be taught in a small group. Say the method is project method, brainstorming, group discussion, demonstration, project work. All these require small class size. And there are some methods for which we provide individualized instruction, like computer assisted instruction or self-learning module. So these provide students individualized instruction Why individualized instruction? Because in these cases, the students are free. They proceed at their own pace, and they are provided with immediate knowledge of result. So we have to think about a suitable method. So as a teacher, I cannot suggest one method of instruction which can be employed for teaching of various subjects in polytechnics and engineering colleges. I think it is left to the teacher, who is the best judge, to decide about a particular method in a particular situation. Another decision he has to take about is instructional material or instructional media needed. Instructional media refer to print media and non-print media. Print media may include manuals, textbooks, charts, pictures, diagrams, whereas non-print media may include video films or audiovisual cassettes, etc. These are required for presenting the instructional stimuli and content. Now, while selecting or while developing instructional media, teacher has to consider some points like the nature of the topic, the level of the students, mode of presentation in the classroom, size of the classroom, the practical factors, the budgetary provision. So these need to be considered if instruction has to be effective. Next decision is about the evaluation procedure. What is evaluation? By evaluation, we mean those activities which are designed to measure student achievement or student attainment of objective brought about as a result of instructional unit of some sort. So the performance objective, I think, is the keystone in developing or in writing items for evaluation. For example, if the objective is that he will be able to state Ohm's law, and naturally you will write an item corresponding to this objective, state Ohm's law. Because if you write what is Ohm's law, that may be measuring something different. So while preparing items for evaluation of student performance, the teacher has to consider two important characteristics of evaluation. One is the reliability, and second is the validity. Now, when it comes to reliability, reliability refers to consistency of results from one measurement to another measurement. That is, if one answer sheet is marked by two separate teachers, then the answer sheet should carry or must carry almost similar marks. Consistency of results. And second is validity. Validity, we say, a test is valid if it measures what it is supposed to measure. As I told you in the beginning, that if the objective is that he will be able to state Ohm's law, then the corresponding question should be state Ohm's law, and not what is Ohm's law, or what do you know about Ohm's law, or what do you understand by Ohm's law, because these three later questions are measuring something different. So you have to think about the reliability and validity of the evaluation procedure. And then we will learn about a format of lesson plan. That is, you can develop your lesson plan using the format that we will take up later. Now, first of all, coming to the concept of instructional objective. Instructional objective is nothing but a sentence or a statement which describes what the student will be able to do at the end of a unit of instruction. So instructional objective help the teacher in three ways. That is, it will help him to define what must be learned. That is, what they will be able to do at the end of a unit of instruction. So you will write two types of objective, general objective and specific objective, as I have already given few examples. Secondly, it will also help the teacher to select instructional method, instructional media for reaching the desired learning outcomes. And thirdly, it is of considerable assistance in planning the assessment procedure. So it will help the teacher in writing the items for evaluation. So instructional objectives help the teacher in three ways. Let me give you the broad classification as given by Bloom and Dewey. That is, the objectives can be classified into three categories, because the overall objective of Polytechnic and engineering colleges is to develop knowledge, skills and attitude among students. Okay, so knowledge refers to the intellectual outcomes. It may include knowledge, understanding, problem solving, and the taxonomy has been given the title as cognitive domain, and there are various levels beginning from remembering to creating. So we will take up one by one later on. Second objective or second category of objective fall under affective domain, which refers to attitudes, interests, values, feelings, emotions, etc. And it has got various levels, beginning from receiving to responding, valuing, organization and characterization. And there is a third set of objectives which fall under psychomotor. Psycho means brain, motor means muscle. So psychomotor means neuromuscular skill, that is, which involves hand and head coordination. So performing some experiment in the laboratory, working on a project in a workshop, or even for a management student, we say putting entries in a ledger. It also requires it is also a skill, and it has also got various levels, beginning with imitation, then manipulation, precision, articulation and naturalization. This session will focus on the cognitive domain, and it has got various level, and at the lowest level is the remembering means recalling previously learned facts, terminology, etc., where we focus on, when we say we focus on specific facts. Water boils at 100 degrees centigrade, SI unit of force is Newton. Or when we say define force, okay, he is simply recalling. So recalling the information, that is his ability to recall, restate and remember the learned information. That requires no understanding. He is simply reproducing, define, state, list, etc. So the behavioral terms which are included in this category are choose, cite, enumerate, label, list, locate, match, name. When I say name one sulfide ore of copper, so it requires no understanding. He is simply naming because he has learned earlier, so he is simply recalling. This is the lowest level. The second in the hierarchy is the comprehension, that is understanding, that is the ability to explain ideas, grasp the meaning of information by interpreting and translating. So if he possesses the lower level of knowledge, that is the remembering, he will be able to translate from one part to another part. When I say convert 100 degree centigrade into corresponding degree Fahrenheit, okay, or suppose I give you some data, I ask you to give the projection for the future trend, okay, that is he is giving the projection, he is interpolating, he is extrapolating. So the behavioral terms included in this category are classify, he is able to convert, he is able to define, describe, estimate. When I say describe each of three Newton's laws of motion with one example. Now in this question, I have given the scope of the topic to be discussed as each of three Newton's laws of motion with one example, and the nature of response is that he is to describe. When I say compare the properties of covalent and electrovalent compounds. Here the scope of the topic is properties of covalent and electrovalent compound, and he is to give the comparison either in the form of a table or he can give the comparison in the form of sentences. Okay, so such verbs are included: explain, express, identify, indicate, interpret, outline, and so on. Now, the next in the hierarchy is the ability to apply the understood material in a new situation. So, using information in another familiar situation is ability to apply classroom learning in a new situation. Okay, how F is equal to MA can be applied in a new situation in solving problem. So, adapt, apply, calculate, change, compute, construct, demonstrate, draw, exhibit, show. These are the behavioral objectives which are included in the category application. The next in the hierarchy is the analysis. Critical thinking, breaking down information into parts to explore the understanding and interrelationships. Now, suppose I ask one question. You have one LCD projector. Can you analyze LCD projector? Now, what do I mean? I mean, you can dismantle LCD projector. Now, you will see that there are various parts and each part has its own, you can say, application. And you are also looking into various relationships, that how one part is related to another part. So, if you do not understand these relationships, you will not be able to put all those parts together to form, assemble it again. So, if you know various parts, if you know their functions, if you know the interrelationships, you will be able to put all these things together. You can also construct something new. Okay. So, analysis is breaking something into its parts and looking into various relationships. So, the behavioral terms included in this category are analyze, appraise, arrange, compare, contrast, criticize, and so on. Next in the category is the evaluation, that is critical thinking, justifying a decision or a course of action. When I say which method is suitable in this situation and why, okay, you are choosing, you are making a decision. So, appraise, assess, choose, compare, and so on. And the last in the hierarchy is the creating, that is critical thinking, which involves generating new idea, product, or ways of viewing things. So, the behavioral terms included are act, assemble, blend, combine, compile, compose, etc. So, now you look into the question paper and you will find that hardly any question is asked which measure students' attainment at the analysis, synthesis, and creating situation. And many questions pertain to the knowledge level or the understanding. When I say write a short note on semiconductor, this requires student ability at the lowest level, that is remembering. And only few questions like describe, explain are given, or some questions pertaining to applications are given. So, we need to bring variety in evaluating the student performance. We must go in some cases up to the creating stage. Now, coming to task analysis, as I told you, it's a process of analyzing an activity, analyzing a complex activity into easier steps. And these steps are then organized in a sequence, and students are taught these steps in a sequence one by one. Okay. So, a process of breaking down or analyzing a task into smaller and more detailed constituent units, and of then sequencing these units of analysis in order of priority based upon their importance in learning. So, task analysis involves two activities. One is analysis, that is breaking down something into its constituent parts, and then putting various relationship, that is we combine all those parts, that is the synthesis part. Now, let me explain this process with an illustration. Topic or task could be a job, say setting up a lathe or say performing experimentation for preparation of carbon dioxide gas, or topic could be a theoretical topic like Ohm's law, solving simultaneous equation, etc. Okay, or it could be a skill. Skill is the further extension of the job. Now, how task analysis is carried out? First of all, the broad topic is analyzed at the level one. For teaching, say, one topic, you need to explain 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These units, 5 units of analysis. Okay, and at the level two, again, analysis is carried out. Say, this fourth sub point, for this, you need to teach this unit, this unit, this unit. So 5 subunits are required to teach this sub unit, that is this fourth unit. Again, we are analyzing into the next level, and you will see that at the bottom the detail is more and at the top the detail was very less. So if this kind of you can say model is available with you, you can develop your lecture with the help of this task analysis, and you need not carry number of pages to the classroom for developing your lecture. Let me give one illustration. Say topic is job of an engine mechanic. Okay, now this job of an engine mechanic can be analyzed into say 5 various jobs. One is tuning the carburetor, adjusting tappets, adjust spark plugs, changing engine oil, and cleaning the spark plug. So these 5 units are required for describing the job of an engine mechanic. Now let us analyze one of these into further activities. Say changing engine oil. The task could be jacking up the car, placing the oil container under the sump, removing the sump plug, and then finally allowing oil to drain away. So these 4 tasks are required to change the engine oil. Now let us take one task, and we can break down into its sub tasks. So the task element for jacking up the car are acquiring right kind of jack, positioning the jack, and manipulating the jack. Okay, so this picture describes the task analysis principles of levels of analysis and increasing detail, and how each levels follows progressively and logically than the one before it. So you will see that there are several levels of analysis, and each succeeding level produces greater detail than the one before it. So this will help you in developing your lecture in the classroom, and this will also help you in writing the instructional objectives. Now the next is very important. As a teacher, we need to understand the general principles of instructional planning. The most important one is that as a teacher, you need to acquire a sound knowledge of the curriculum requirements and the content. You see, students learn most from those teachers who have a complete understanding of the curriculum requirements and the content. So as a teacher, you need to know to what depth this particular topic has to be dealt. Okay, so this is very important. Second is, plan instruction on the basis of what your students actually know and understand, and not on an assumption of what they should have learned in the previous lecture. You see, students are disadvantaged by those teachers who presume that the students have complete understanding of the content of previous lecture. Very bad. So because you see, sometimes we assume that students are already familiar with this. So that assumption must be tested before coming to the actual topic. Now let me give you one example. Say I ask you one thing: what is the position of this object if I place it on the table? Is it moving or is it at rest? You will definitely say that it is at rest. Okay, now suppose I switch on the fan and ask the question: what is the position of this fan? The obvious answer would be it is in motion. Very right. Now this object, when I place it on the table, it is not moving. Is it? It is at rest. How can I bring it into motion? You will definitely say that by pushing or by pulling, that object can be made into action. Okay, it can be made into motion. Okay, so that is the pushing or pulling is nothing but force. And I ask few more questions. Suppose you are sitting in a moving bus and the driver suddenly applies brakes. What happens? You will definitely say that we will fall forward. And what happens when the driver suddenly starts the bus? We go backward. Now the next question is, why are these due to? Now your students are quite motivated to learn the reason. You have aroused their curiosity. Now this is the time to answer the question. In fact, announce the topic. You will say that these are due to laws of inertia. So today in this session, we will learn about laws of inertia. Now you see here, before teaching the concept of inertia, it is essential that student must be familiar with the concept of rest, concept of motion, and concept of force. So you must proceed from what they know and move slowly, slowly to what they do not know. Another principle is prepare specific instructional objectives for every topic or for every lesson. So always write general objective. It could be one or two, and you can write 4 to 6 specific objectives for each general objective. I have given you example of Ohm's law, and that you can also communicate to the student when you enter in the class, that today after this session is over, you will be able to understand Ohm's law, you will be able to state, you will be able to define, you will be able to draw, and so on. So that must be communicated to the student. Then another decision he has to take is about the specific instructional strategies that are appropriate. So you see, a proper match of instructional method, instructional media, student need, and curriculum requirement facilitate appropriate learning. So as a teacher, you have to see which method is suitable in this case, which media is required, what is the curriculum requirement, what is the nature of the student. So if there is a proper match, then that will promote meaningful learning. Then always go for 3 phases in your presentation: a beginning, a middle, and a conclusion. A beginning must include 2 activities. One is review of prerequisites and overview of your lecture. Because a beginning is just like the warm-up phase of your presentation. So it must fire the imagination of your student. I gave you one example about the inertia, laws of inertia. So the beginning was that I gave you the overview of the prerequisites, and then I told you about the content which would be covered in the presentation. Let me take one more example. What are the constituents of air? Obvious answer could be oxygen, nitrogen, carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, and so on. My next question is, which gas do we inhale? Obviously, you would say oxygen. I will say, wonderful. Which gas do we exhale? Carbon dioxide gas, wonderful. Which gas is available in soda water bottle? Carbon dioxide gas, wonderful. Which gas is used to extinguish fire? You will get the response as carbon dioxide gas. Say, wonderful. Now, you see, carbon dioxide gas has got various applications. How this gas can be prepared? Now, students are quite motivated to learn something new because you have created a need. You have given them a rationale how this gas can be prepared. So, you can say that carbon dioxide gas can be prepared by treating calcium carbonate with hydrochloric acid. So today in this session, we will learn preparation of carbon dioxide gas. Now you go to board and write in the middle of the board, preparation of carbon dioxide gas. And in this session, first of all, we will learn the reactants required for, you can write on the left hand side of the board in bullet forms, reactants required. Then second bullet would be a laboratory setting of apparatus. Third bullet could be precautions to be taken while preparing carbonized gas. And another could be, a bullet could be procedure. Then physical property, chemical properties, advantages, disadvantages. So you have given them an overview of your lecture. So that must be written, that must be retained throughout your lecture. So beginning must include review of prerequisite, and second is overview of your lecture. Then the middle. Middle must include various activities like lecturing, demonstrating, involving their participation through asking questions or through inviting questions. Then you are also assigning some tasks, you are motivating, you are explaining, and so on. And at the end, the conclusion, that is the consolidation phase, which requires two activities. One is summarization of what you have covered in the class. That is, always have a summary at the end, wherein you are summarizing whatever you have covered, and also you are asking few questions to know about the understanding level of students. And thirdly, you will give them some assignment by which they will be able to apply classroom learning in a new situation. Plan interesting and challenging learning experiences. Students participate actively in those learning experiences which they find enjoyable and stimulating. So always try to link with examples from word to word, or always bring some, you can say, variety in the classroom through the use of media. Plan for meaningful learning. This is possible only if you are trying to link the new learning with examples from daily life. So that will promote meaningful learning. Another is that students benefit from planned assignment that contain both easy and difficult material graded to student abilities. There are variety of students sitting in the classroom. Some are above average, majority of them are below average, average, and few of them belong to the below average category. So you devise different kinds of assignment. Very tough assignment can be given to gifted student. Very small exercise or very simple exercise can be given to below average student, because once he experiences a success in a simple exercise, he would like to repeat that behavior in future. Perhaps he would like to take up somewhat difficult assignment in future. So the purpose is that he should experience success in the beginning. Organize a regular assessment schedule. Students benefit from instructional planning that allow them to see, that allow them monitoring of their learning progress throughout their session. So always have a sectional recapitulation. Suppose you have thought of 4 points to be covered in a lecture. After completing one part, you ask one or two questions. After completing second, again one or two questions pertaining to second part, and so on. So organize a regular assessment schedule. And another is very important, be prepared to adapt plans that do not achieve stated objectives. Sometimes you are not able to finish the entire content which you have brought in the classroom because of many reasons. The reason could be power failure. The reason could be that the technology doesn't work. That is, you have brought one CD or pen drive, and the PowerPoint presentation is not opening up. So you must be ready. You must be flexible in order to admit, okay, no problem, I will develop my lecture on the board itself. So be prepared to adapt any changes which are required. So always think about the alternate. Now coming to events of instruction. You see, in a teaching learning situation, teacher tries to take the student from what they know to what they do not know. So from moving from what they know to what they do not know, a number of events takes place which acts upon the students and in which student becomes involved. So in other words, we will say that events of instruction are designed to make it possible for the learner to proceed from where he is at the beginning of a lecture to the attainment of capabilities identified as the lesson's objective. Brigg and Gaine has identified 9 events of instruction, and we will see when and how many times these events of instruction can be applied in a lecture situation. The first is gaining attention. I think it is required throughout the lecture. The purpose is to alert the student to the reception of the stimuli, and attention in general can be gained by rapid introduction of stimulus change. Now there are many tips to gain student attention. You have seen there is always a lecture stand in the classroom and teacher stands stationary and he goes on explaining from this particular point. Now some students are watching me from a particular angle, some students are watching me from some another angle. Since there is no change in my posture, naturally there will be no change in their posture. So they will tolerate me for some time, and after that they will experience fatigue. So the tip is, instead of standing stationary, bring purposeful movement. Now in this particular situation, I am not able to move because camera is fixed and I am not supposed to move. But in actual classroom, I must go to this side slowly and give my glance to that particular section of class. Then I slowly I can move inside. The purpose is to alert them to the reception of the stimulus. So I can see my eyes open, someone is not making a photo or making a full patty, which normally students, when they don't get attention, they normally do in the classroom. So instead of standing stationary, one needs to bring purposeful movements. Now the second thing is, normally teacher stands stationary and they also keep their hands in their pockets like this. Some teachers stand like this. Some teachers, they always keep their hand on the table, okay? And some teachers, what they do, they pick up one chalk, they break that chalk into 2 pieces, then they start playing like this, okay? So I'm standing like this. I say, in front of my house, there's a big house. Now I will repeat this sentence again. I say, in front of my house, there's a big house. So the second tip to gain attention is meaningful gestures. When I say rainbow is like this, so my hand should move like this. So I must supplement whatever I am telling orally with my gestures. Okay, so meaningful gesture. Then another component is voice modulation, that is change of voice. Suppose you want to highlight some point, you will say, these are due to laws of inertia. Now you must have noticed I have paused a little also between due to and laws of inertia. This is pausing is another component to gain attention. Another component is changing interactional pattern. Interaction is two-way, okay? So instead of explaining throughout the lecture, I can insert few questions or I can invite questions. So now the student will participate. So interaction is now different, okay? They will participate. So because there are expectations of the students. Student says, if you tell me, I will forget. If you show me, I may remember. But if you involve me, I will be always with you. So we need to involve their participation in the classroom. Another is oral visual switching. A-U-R-A-L. Oral involves sense of hearing. Visual involves sense of sight. So switch over from one mode to another. That is, instead of explaining, you go to board and write something. Now they will see, or you show some chart, or so you show the PowerPoint presentation. So oral visual switching. And one more component that is required to gain attention is to give your glance to each and every student sitting in the classroom. So maintain an eye contact with each and every students sitting in the classroom, because there are some teachers who always give their glance to their favorite student sitting in the front row, okay, and the rest of the students or the students sitting at the back bench are neglected. So after that, they will tolerate me for some time. After that, they will start playing their games, or they may indulge themselves in some kind of daydreaming. So these tips are required to gain the attention of the students. Then when a teacher enters the classroom, all the students want to know why they are sitting in the classroom. So that why part must be communicated to the student. So always inform your students about objectives of instruction, and you also specify on the board, in the on the left hand side of the board, you can give the objectives in the form of bullets. Then ensure prerequisites of learners. Prerequisites, what they already know. So that overview you can give, or you may ask pertaining to those prerequisites, you may ask few questions to test the prerequisites. Then presenting the stimulus material. So bring variation, provide varied learning experiences when you are presenting the stimulus material. Providing learning guidance. You can give them some clue. You can say this is a hint. Okay, you can give assignment and say hint is there. So that will be very much helpful to them for solving the problem. Then ask them to show their performance. Yes, you can show, or you invite some student on the board. Now write the next step. So they will write or they will draw. And then you will need to give informative, or you can say constructive feedback. That is very essential. If you ask few questions and the student is answering, you say, wonderful, you have said very rightly. Or you say, your answer is slightly wrong. You have said this way, the answer is this. Okay. So the idea is to improve. The idea is not to prove that you are always wrong. So always give them informative feedback. Suppose you have given some assignment, so you must give conscientious marking. That is, many people write checked, noted. This is not feedback. Somebody just say scope for improvement. This is not a feedback. You need to write what is the gap. You specify the gap so that the student will be able to improve upon that gap. Then assessing student performance. So you can go for sectional recapitulation, as well as you can ask at the end of your lecture the whole that is the question pertaining to the whole chapter. Enhancing retention and transfer. And this is possible only if you give them at the end of your lecture some sort of assignment by which they are able to apply the classroom learning in a new situation. If they are successful in linking what you are telling, that will be helpful, that will help them retain the information for a longer period of time, and that will also transfer the classroom learning in a new situation. So always go for some kind of assignment at the end of the lecture. Now let me give you the format of a lesson plan. I have prepared a standardized format for you. Write the topic, name of the teacher, the subject, the class, place, date. Then always write three types of objective. One is general objectives. It could be one or two. And for this, you will use the terms understand or know. And for the specific objective, you will use the action verb which I have given in the earlier part of my presentation. And the third is readiness objective, because in learning some topics, certain prerequisites are required. These prerequisites are the capabilities the students already acquired prior to instruction, which indicate their readiness to learn new topic. So I gave you an example of laws of inertia. Now, and for this topic, the teacher assumed that my students are already familiar with the concept of rest, concept of motion, concept of force. So how you can state the readiness objective? You can say the student can define rest, he can define motion, he can list situation where push is given or pull is given. Okay, So, whereas in general objective and specific objective, you will use the word like he will be able to, because at the end of instruction he will be able to achieve. Whereas readiness objective are required to know the level of prerequisites. Now, then you will prepare a table. You will have five columns: phase column, objective, instruction activities, media required, and time allocated for that thing. Introduction. Now, for introduction of your lecture, you can think of any one of these three activities, like describe activities that explain the relevance of learning the content of the lesson and what is to be learned in the lesson. Or you can think about the activities that may arouse the curiosity of learning the content, or it could be the activities that will test the presence of prerequisites in the students. And if you require any media, you can give its reference and how much time you require for the introduction of your lecture, that estimation of time can be given. Then the development phase, you specify the objective one. You need not write the content, you need to write only the methodology. Describe the strategy of presenting the information in respect of the objective to be achieved, and write the activities for the assessing the achievement of objective. And what media you require, you can give a reference, that chart showing or PowerPoint showing or model and so on. And how much time you require, you can also mention. Then similarly, you can go for third objective, fourth, fifth, and sixth, and so on. Then the last part is the closure, where you include the activities for summarizing, evaluation of the lesson objective, and follow-up, and which media is required and how much time. So the timing column gives an indication of the pacing of the lesson. Now let me focus on the second aspect of my presentation, that is the delivery of instruction. So introductory phase, state the instruction objective clearly after creating the necessity. Always explain the rationale why we are learning this topic. Okay, then you can announce your topic, and on the left hand side you give them an overview of your lecture. As I told you in the beginning, the introductory phase must include two activities. One is review of prerequisites and overview of lecture. And always say that in this session we will learn. Never say, today I will teach, I am going to talk to you about this thing, I will discuss, and today my topic is this. Because the students will say, sir, this is your headache, please go and break your head. So when the students know that the teacher is also learning, that will give them motivation. So always say that in this session we will learn, and never say I will teach. Now the development will include the explanation. It is nothing but a comprehensive exposition that increases students' understanding of the subject matter. So explain the content with the help of examples. And secondly, when you are developing your presentation, you can also use the demonstration as a method. Actually, demonstration means means to show something. But in teaching subjects in engineering and technology, it means much more than mere showing. It means showing how something is to be done or not to be done. So a demonstration is nothing but a physical display of the form, outline, or substance, or objects, or events for the purpose of increasing the knowledge, understanding of those objects or events. So even you can explain the, you can give the give examples or non-example as a part of demonstrating the concept. Then another important aspect that has to be taken into consideration while making a presentation is questioning. It has got number of applications. Questions facilitate communication. When you are questioning, you are asking questions, you are involving their participation. They are interacting with you. that also focuses attention on particular aspects of the topic. So you are asking questions pertaining to some aspect of your lecture. Evaluate students' knowledge. Understanding of the subject matter. It also stimulates thinking, and you can also use questioning to control the social behavior of students. Suppose some student is creating indiscipline, so you can ask one question directly to him so that he can give his attention to your presentation. Now, while asking question, two things come to mind: what question to ask and how to ask question. So what question to ask? Question must be relevant to instruction objectives. These must not be out of the place questions. These must pertain to the topic directly, and you can ask varied levels of question suiting to varied levels of students sitting in the classroom. A tough question to a gifted student, simple question to a below average student, and use familiar vocabulary, because this facilitates effective and efficient communication. So suppose your student has not understood the question you have asked, you can analyze that question into small question. The idea is to give them some hint. So the idea is to use the language in which your students can understand. So use familiar words. Now, how to ask questions? One question at a time. No need to ask 3-4 questions in one go. So one question, second question, third question. Question should begin from easy to difficult mode. And first of all, you distribute the question to all the students. Give them some time to think about the answer. Let them raise their hands, and then invite one or two students to respond to your question. So give adequate time. How to respond to students' answer is another consideration. So you say, very well said. You have said very rightly, wonderful. Or you can give informative feedback like, your answer is partially wrong because you have said like this, this is not the right thing. So you are taking him to the right answer. Then assigning work tasks. So meaningful and related to instruction objectives, give hints if required. So always give them homework, although it is a concept of the schools, but in polytechnics and engineering colleges, the teachers are required to give to assign tasks to the students, whether they do or do not do, but they will definitely do it if you give them assignments every day. Another very important component which teachers usually discuss: what can we do to motivate students to learn? You see, the answer, the question is very straightforward, but the answer is not simple, because the typical procedures that the teachers employ for motivating students are very often indirect and subtle. Motivation, why is it needed? Actually, it is concerned with why of behavior, the reason behind student putting in effort. So various approaches have been viewed to reduce student resistance to learn. Okay, so students can be motivated intrinsically, they can also be motivated extrinsically. Now, what is extrinsic motivation? Students who aim for who study to achieve good grades, or who try to please their teacher to get their attention, are extrinsically motivated. According to behavioral approach, it is not inherent in the behavior. It is something which is administered by some external agent. At home, if father says if you get all A's, you will get 500 rupees or you will get bike. So here 500 rupee note or bike is acting as an extrinsic motivation. Okay, so it is not inherent. Likewise, intrinsic motivation: students who aim for personal satisfaction from reading a book or who have inherent desire to learn about a science topic are intrinsically motivated. So intrinsic motivation can be conceived as a state forcing the individual to do something or to learn something for his personal satisfaction or to broaden his personal to broaden his mental horizon, whereas extrinsic motivation can be considered as a state under which the student does not learn of his own accord but under the influence of external motivators. So as a teacher, we need to identify which factors are reinforcing and which factors are punishing. Accordingly, he can provide the reinforcement to the student. And here I would like to explain the stimulus response reinforcement model. Stimulus is something, an object, an event, or a process that leads to a response. Now, it could be an object, it could be a person, or it could be an event. Now, you see, I have got one object in my hand. You are looking at this particular object. You are looking at the LCD projector. You are looking at the screen. So, you are forming some kind of response. So, stimulus. Second is response. Response is a unit of behavior that follows that particular stimulus. Okay. When you are looking at this, you are forming some response. When you are looking at the LCD projector or screen, you are forming another kind. So you are giving that response when it is asked. And the third is reinforcement. What is reinforcement? A consequence of the response. Okay. So stimulus, response, reinforcement. So now let me explain. If a particular stimulus response chain or pair is accompanied by a desirable consequence, then it will be more likely that the stimulus involved will prompt the same response in future. So, a behavior which is accompanied by satisfaction or reward on the part of individual is likely to be permanent or repeated than the behavior which is accompanied by dissatisfaction or failure on the part of the learner. And there are many techniques which can be employed for motivating the student. To mention a few are, one is providing anxiety-free or tension-free environment in the class. So, because in such kind of environment, the students feel free to discuss among themselves and of course with the teacher also. Secondly, when you enter the classroom, always smile at them. And don't enter the classroom with an attitude, oh, again there is a class. So always enter the classroom with an attitude that I am going to enjoy my people. So smile at them. Set SMART goals. S stands for specified, M stands for measurable, A stands for attainable, R stands for relevant, T stands for time bound. So goal must be like SMART goal. When I say define force, this SMART goal, because it is giving the direction to the student in the form of the scope of the topic and the nature of the response. But if I ask, what is force? What do you know about force? What do you understand by force? So that these kinds of questions do not give any direction, and the different students, they interpret these questions differently, and naturally their answers will be organized differently. So, in order to provide valid and reliable result, you have to ask specified questions. Another phase is the consolidation phase, where the teacher has to summarize his lecture. And during summarization phase, the teacher has to ask few questions for assessing their performance. And for assessing the performance of the student, the teacher has to use variety of test items. And test items can be classified into two categories depending on how you expect your student to respond to those questions. Your students could either supply an answer to a question by a word, by number, by few sentences or more sentences. Or your student could select an appropriate response from a set of responses supplied along with the question. So we have got two types of item: supply type item, selection type item. So supply type items require the student to supply an answer to a question by a word. When I say name one sulfide ore of copper, so he is supplying the answer by a word. When I say define force, so he is supplying the answer in few words. When I say 8 is what percentage of 64? He is supplying the answer by a number. When I say describe each of three Newton's laws of motion with an example, so he is giving an elaborative answer. Whereas selection type items can be of alternate response, multiple choice or matching type. So the teacher has to use variety of test item to measure different learning outcomes. Don't use only one kind of test item. And here the role of the teacher is to provide feedback and performance correctness. So feedback is nothing but information that is fed back to individuals about the appropriateness of their actions or responses, whereas correctives are the procedures intended to rectify errors in responding or inadequacies in learning. So obtain reliable assessment of students' task performance before giving feedback and corrective, and teacher has to manage the time also. He has to ensure that his lecture is completed within this stipulated time, and this is possible only if he or she has prepared the lesson plan and has also thought about planning for delivery of instruction in the class. So with these words, I close this particular session, and if you have any question or you want to seek any clarification, you are welcome. So audience from various places, you are welcome to ask any question. Yes, please. From Alwar, from Derabasi, from Ludhiana. So any question you want to ask, you are welcome. If you have no question, okay, thank you very much. And we will reassemble at 2:15. 15 minutes past 2. So kindly assemble in your respective institution at 15 minutes past 2.
ठीक है तो पढ़ाई सर ने अब क्या कहना है ऊपर सवा दो मुझे मैडम ने कहा था तो 45 मिनट तो देने ही देने थे।